Ladies and gentlemen, it gives us great pleasure to present to you The Zoo, a musical folly by Sir Arthur Sullivan, with words by Bolton Rowe. Originally conceived as a light-hearted tilt at the conventions of grand opera, it was first performed at the St. James's Theatre on June the 5th, 1875. However, the score was then lost to sight for many years, and this recording is its first performance by the D'Oyly Carte Opera Company. As you will note from my, present accompaniment, the dramatic action takes place in London's famous Zoological Gardens. Or to be more precise, between the bear pit and the refreshment stall there. Aesculapius Carboy, a modest chemist, is determined to hang himself because he is prevented from marrying Letitia, the daughter of Mr. Grinder, a retired grocer. Eliza Smith, in charge of the refreshment stall, persuades him not to. She, in turn, a delightful opportunist, is being courted by Thomas Brown, alias the Duke of Islington, in disguise because he is searching for a partner of true virtue. Carboy is first heard, on a chair, and with a rope round his neck, attached to the veranda of the refreshment store.
Forbear! Fresh one, we say, forbear!
Will somebody just kick the chair, and let me dangle in the air? I'm tired of life.
Why always hang yourself up high? If that's the way you choose to die.
But let us know the reason why.
Is it your wife?
No. Listen. I loved her fondly, and her father had been a grocer. But when I sought her hand, he hastily answered, "No, sir, your offer I refuse. If ever my girl should marry, she'll marry whom I choose, and not an apothecary."
His hand indeed refuses, for an apothecary.
No meetings day or night, no letters with such restrictions. At last I thought I might communicate in prescriptions, by her whom I adore in token of love were taken. The mixture, as before, I trust was nicely shaken. One day I saw arrive a letter which from her sister implored me to contrive to send her papa a blister. What joy pervades my heart, see vengeance is now arriving. I'll scarify the part with devilish heart contriving.
Scarify the part with devilish heart contriving.
A dose of peppermint I thought might please her rather. I sent it her when I sent the blister for her father. But when I called next day, bad fortune had turned the tables. I much regret to say my boy had changed the labels. And now, my friends, you see the reason for my emotion. The draught of life for me has turned to a bitter potion. I cannot but suppose of what happened you have a notion. Her father used the dose and Letitia took the lotion.
Her father used the dose and Letitia took the lotion.
And now let's go back to where we were. And if you please remove the chair.
Rash man! Again, we say forbear.
Withdraw the chair. Withdraw the chair.
Young man, I say get out of that. What on earth may you be at? Destroy yourself. You shan't, that's flat.
Rash man, forbear.
A cruel fate, a cruel fate.
Apples, oranges, lemonade, ginger beer, soda water.
That voice, that lovely voice I know so well. Its accents tender make my bosom swell with deep emotion. You're a rival,
Thomas, dear.
Maiden fair, pray have a care. You should not try your slave. Beware, beware, my feelings bear. He back the heart I gave.
Oh, Thomas Brown, withdraw the frown that mantles on your brow. Around the town, both up and down, there's nothing to you.
A maiden friend.
Oh, Thomas Brown.
Pray have a care.
Withdraw the frown.
Oh, come, my love, to the shady grove,
and there we'll roam alone. And as we roam,
my love, I'll pray
beneath the setting sun. And
come, my love.
cannot say.
Say, have you seen my lost one pass this way?
Ah, cruel fate, Letitia, or her ghost?
Beloved, then you are not lost.
Say, is it you?
It is, my foolish sister, that message sent me took.
Then where's the blister?
The blister is upon my father's back.
It is. Now, heavenly powers, be thanked for that. Once more the face I loved so well returns, returns to shed a ray of sunshine o'er my solitude and change the night to day.
Let me gaze upon thy face and lean upon thy breast and find upon thy noble heart an everlasting rest
and find upon thy noble heart an everlasting rest an everlasting rest.
How much, oh, how much?
You've had four tarts and a couple of pears. You've had three buns of ferment for the bears. Two bags of nuts instead of the apes. 10 biscuits of various sizes and shapes.
Oh.
3 packets of superfine lollipops. 1 ounce of the very best pineapple drops. The largest cake you ever did see. And a 1/2-pound packet of ornaments tea.
I've eaten as much as a man could eat. I've gone through a very remarkable feat. From the tuppenny tart to the kidney pie, I've swallowed as much as I could have I. Ooh. How better could a man his affection prove than by stuffing himself for the sake of his love? With a bottle of pop I have quenched my thirst. And now, if you please, I am ready to burst.
4 tarts, 3 buns and a couple of pears.
It is essential for a man in his condition that he should not be crowded. Pray, stand back.
It is essential for a man in his condition that he should not be crowded or changing his position. So stand back, 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 stand back.
Prop him up upon a chair.
Leave him flat upon his back.
Give him lots of room and air.
It's a most severe attack. Turn him round upon his face.
Turn him round the other way.
Let him have a little space.
Do not crowd upon him, pray.
Turn him round upon his face.
Turn him round the other way.
Let him have
have a little space.
Do not crowd upon him, pray.
Give him brandy. That's the brand. That's the thing to do him good.
Brandy, why you kill the man?
No, it wouldn't.
Yes, it would.
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 It was the last bun.
Thank heaven he breathes again.
He breathes again. Oh joy without a lie.
Oh joy.
Oh joy without a lie.
Say, who will this prescription take?
Yes, who will this prescription take?
I will, I fly.
She flies, she flies.
I will, I fly.
She will, she flies.
I will, I fly.
She flies, she flies.
Appear in disguise.
Oh yes, he's appear in disguise. We can tell by the look of his eyes.
Oh yes, he's appear in disguise. We can tell by the look of his eyes. He's appear, he's appear, he's appear, he's appear, he's
appear, he's tell me how you find me in this place.
Nor better now, as time will show, your gracious, gracious grace.
Your grace?
Your gracious, gracious grace.
Discovered. Well, I confess, yes, I'm a man of high degree.
That we'll feel, that we'll feel.
A member of the aristocracy.
Oh, let us kneel.
Nay, do not kneel. In search of virtue have I wandered here and found it in this humble sphere.
Oh, let us kneel.
Nay, do not kneel.
Oh, let us kneel.
Nay, do
let
not
us
kneel. Ladies and gentlemen, accustomed as I am to public
speaking,
thank you, speaking, I feel
overpowered.
Thank you. No, you're overwhelmed upon this
occasion.
Thank you, occasion. Yeah, and I also feel that your feelings, that they
feel.
Thank you. If you could
feel.
Thank you, if you could feel as I feel.
Hear him.
Thank you, I...
Hear him.
Thank you.
Hear him.
Read Arthur from what you have said, that Eliza you fondly adore, that you worship and love her instead of the ladies you worshipped before, that she is a realized dream of your life and whatever her station, by marriage you show your esteem for a virtue and high reputation.
Precisely, it was my intention that the sense of my words should be such. Your wonderfully quick comprehension and intelligence pleases me much.
Why so, if that be the case, and it seems we at last understand, we now would suggest to your grace.
Your wishes with pleasure I meet. Give me time just to change my condition and offer with joy at her feet myself and my ducal position.
Our wishes delight him to meet. Give him time just to change his condition and offer with joy at her feet.
The Duke departs with Letitia and Carboy. But wait, who is this? None other than the villain of our piece, Mr. Grinder, the hard-hearted grocer.
Where is my daughter? Oh, if I caught her, if I could find her.
Grinder! Miss Grinder!
Yes, it's Grinder.
Oh, confounded, don't do that. I've a blister on my back. Someone said she'd wandered here, and with Carboy too, I fear, my wicked daughter.
Grinder, it's Grinder.
Yes, it's Grinder.
Oh, confounded, don't do that. I've a blister on my back. And what with the potion, and what with the lotion, I haven't a notion what to expect.
What with the potion?
My ways are nice and mild, and I never harmed a soul in all me life. And I don't know what is wrong, as my principles are strong for this hemisphere of wickedness and strife. I have bracelets, it is true, and I've diamonds, just a few, that are locked up in a chest of drawers at home. And a dressing case with tops of gold and diamond drops, but I haven't an idea from whence they come. And the bouquets come in showers of the most expensive flowers that Covent Garden Market can provide. While it happened once last year that a peacock did appear, the very best of thoroughbreds to ride. I have dresses by the dozens, but they're given me by cousins who have known me ever since I was that high. And tickets for the play are sent me every day, but I'm sure I never can imagine why. In the season I have been, and for the reason that I did not like my cousin to offend. But I saved my reputation, to his very great vexation, by driving back to London with his friend. On more than one occasion, after very great persuasion, I have driven down to Richmond with his brother. And once I do remember, in the middle of September, to Hampton Court I travelled with another. It is true I went to Dover when the season was just over, but then it was with George, I should say Harry. And Harry, I mean Charlie, or was it Thomas Parley, was the only man I ever meant to marry. It might have been the other, or it might have been his brother, but neither could I ever bear to part. And whichever of the two, it really was, it's true, I loved him from the bottom of me.
Fetch me a rope. Fetch him a rope, fetch him a rope, fetch him a rope.
Poor Carboy, rope in hand, now goes towards the bear pit.
Very well, Adisha, very well.
Very well.
Very well.
Savior is at hand. Re-enter Thomas Brown in his full regalia as the Duke of Islington.
What do I see in this disguise? Tom Brown, can I believe me eyes?
Tis he. Recover your surprise. Tom Brown assumes his native guise. Eliza, if you'll marry me, the proudest lady you shall be that ever London town did see. Eliza, say that you will be the Duchess of Islington.
The Duchess of Islington.
The Duchess of Islington.
Oh, ask me not to leave this spot, the beasts I love so well. The grief I feel at this appeal, no mortal man can tell. The grisly one will miss his bone, the bone he thought so nice. The polar bear in blank despair will ask in vain for ice. Oh, and who will feed that lanky steed, the camel-leopard? From these two parts it breaks my heart, it's very, very hard.
Nay, dry your tears, these needless fears one word shall chase away. I've bought them all, the great and small, they go with us today. And every morn at early dawn, the gentle armadillo or rattlesnake, when you awake, you'll find upon your pillow the parrot too and cockatoo shall lull you to repose. The nice baboon and strong raccoon shall titivate your nose.
A nice baboon,
a nice baboon,
a nice baboon.
My dove, my wife,
with happiness I die.
but now,
oh, cruel fate, too late, too late.
One moment, allow me to explain.
What's here again?
Require us a sympathy and give you a minute. Why not die?
In consequence of some repairs, I much regret they've moved the bears. But I will try the lion's den once more, the bears I'll brave. And then...
The sacrifice would needless prove. I've heard the story of your love. On his consent you now may count. And here is double the amount.